friends, we gather here in the name of the Father and of the Son and Holy Spirit, in the presence of God's healing love. I'm Reverend Ashley Grant, and along with Reverend Adam and our church family and friends, we welcome you to this sanctuary at First United Church of Christ, where Ardienne worshiped for decades, to this church where she served and participated in fellowship. We also welcome all of those who are worshiping with us online and those worshiping with us in spirit. With sadness and gratitude, we gather here where we are free to pour out our grief, acknowledge our loss, and know that love endures. We gather here as one people, conscious of others who have died and of the frailty of our own existence on earth. We come to comfort and to support one another in our common loss. We gather to hear a word of hope that can drive away our despair and move us to offer our praise. We gather to give thanks for the life of Ardienne Damicis and honor the life she lived and the love she leaves for you as a blessing. So I invite those who are able to stand as we begin our service with the call to worship. Almighty God, whose will is sovereign and whose mercy is boundless, look upon us in our sorrow and enable us to hear your word. Help us to hear so that through patience and the encouragement of the scriptures, we may hold fast to the assurance of your favor and the hope of life eternal. Through Jesus Christ, our risen Savior. Amen.
You may be seated. Hear now these promises of God, beginning with words from the 40th chapter of the prophet Isaiah. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Here ends this reading. And from Matthew 11, we hear these words. Jesus said, "Come to me, all you who are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Will you pray with me? Almighty God, whose yoke is light, you whose will is pure, grant that your Holy Spirit may intercede for us with sighs too deep for human words. Through the veil of our tears, assure us again that ear has not heard, nor eye seen, nor human imagination envisioned what you have prepared for those who love you. Assure us that we might know more fully that your servant, Ardienne, has joined in the passion and victory of your son, Jesus, who was dead and buried, but who has everlasting life. We pray this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now would all of those who are able to please stand as we sing from the red or burgundy hymnal found in the pew rack in front of you, the Pilgrim Hymnal, hymn number 1, Our God, Our Help in Ages Past. May be seated. I now invite forward Katie Murphy to read from the Psalms.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures, he leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
I now invite forward Dave Gregory for a reading.
Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 through 8. For everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek, a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to sow, a time to keep silent, a time to speak, a time to love, and a time to hate, a time for war, and a time for peace.
And now I invite forward Mary Lou to offer a reading from Matthew's Gospel.
Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you.
And from Paul's letter to Timothy, he writes, "As for me, I am already being poured out as a libation, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. May God add rich blessing to these readings of Holy Word that Ardienne chose for all of us. Amen." Paul the Apostle knows that he is not long for this world. He offers his final word of encouragement to Timothy to take the baton, continue the work, carry this story God entrusted to him, and now to Timothy, the good news of Christ. It is beautiful as it is painful. Paul, knowing he had fought the good fight, finished the race, though it was through incredible physical challenge and suffering, and through grace-filled experiences and joy. Winning wasn't on Paul's mind, finishing was. Paul knew he had kept the faith while trying to care for so many communities he had helped to shape and nurture. His departure was imminent, and he knew he had poured himself out into this life God called him to, which now he felt was a drink offering poured out to God. Ardienne's life was a libation poured out to honor God. Ardienne fought the good fight with courage and endured the race with poise and perseverance and persistence, even through years of physical struggles. Ardienne carried story and history and at every turn encouraged others to take up that story and continue the work. So it is good and right to honor her, to receive these words from Scripture of blessing and wisdom and hope that she wanted to share with all of us as we gather in this moment, tinged with sadness, though saturated in our love for Ardienne. Beloved daughter, cousin, teacher, wife, aunt, friend, neighbor, mentor, historian, herb crafter, preservationist, actress, who has died after 84 rich years. A few years ago, Ardienne and Karen and I met to talk about her plans and even this service. That's how prepared Ardienne was. She was full of gratitude for Karen and Phil and Bill and your families and for her neighbors and friends who had supported her through very difficult times. Ardienne had been a fixture in the community for so many decades, planting curiosity among children and cultivating an imperative to be lifelong learners. So that was a special time that we shared to hear more about her childhood and the experiences that shaped her and nurtured her hopes. Ardienne was born into the world to Philip and Shirley Waldron days after the great hurricane of 1938, when destruction and loss stretched across the region. During the Great War that would follow, Ardienne and her mom lived in Woodbridge while her dad was in the Pacific and while her grandparents were in New Haven and in Milford. She moved to Baltimore when she was in the fourth grade, and her dad managed a pie-making factory. Then they moved to New Haven, where he would work with the Rodell Manufacturing Company and her grandparents before making their way to Greenwich. Now, I was so surprised to hear about Ardienne's childhood growing up at the homestead in Greenwich, Connecticut, which dates back to Abraham Meade, who built the farmhouse there in 1799. Her mom seemed to be a Jane of all trades, so when her parents purchased the homestead in 1950, her mom fixed it up. Ardienne learned the ins and outs of hospitality, how to pick up the pieces after a boiler room explosion, the delight of installing a pool, and that hotel administration was not her calling. Turned out teaching was her calling, and she started teaching at Orchard Hills as a fourth grade teacher and then moved to fifth grade. This setting allowed her to pull together all the pieces, all the things she enjoyed. Everything from American history to literature like Charlotte's Web to science and experiments, along with working with children. As she settled into the community of Milford, her parents also moved to Milford, and this is where she would enjoy and love going to the beach and where she would meet Dan and then grow to love his family. She immersed herself in the community. From the Historical Society to this First Church of Christ Congregational, where she was a joiner. She joined the choir. She joined the deacons. She was the historian. And then following in the footsteps of her father's mother, she picked up the mantle of studying genealogy. She would light up. Oh my goodness, when she talked about history and connections, whether it was 10 generations removed from Peter Pruden, to how James Baldwin was excommunicated from the church for lying and being obnoxious, or the risque behavior of an ancestor who kissed his wife on a Sunday. She loved the humor and resourcefulness of people who called this place home, and after she and Dan got married, Their place on Beach Avenue became the homestead that Ardienne loved. About 10 years ago, we were set to celebrate our 375th anniversary here at Milford and with the church. I approached Ardienne with, "Let's run a colonial camp this summer." Her yes was like a starter's pistol. Within 24 hours, Ardienne and I met in the parlor, she with her stacks of materials, toys, plans, accessories, logistics strategies, schedules, and recipes. We were going to host a collaborative and integrated experience with the Historical Society. That year, my admiration for Ardienne exploded. Perhaps because I love when people aren't afraid to put on a costume. Perhaps because she saw the importance of play when one is learning about history. Perhaps because she just worked so hard. Perhaps because she knew the value of pulling together connections to bring an enriching and inspiring experience to all. Perhaps because of the pace she kept visiting historical landmarks, almost like it was a race. Not about winning, but about planting seeds of the story of Milford, about the good news of resilience and hope among real people, and that story is the treasure that will outlive our bodies and continue to shape the future if we let it. Ardienne embodied the wonder of Rachel Carson there at the edge of the shore that she loved so dearly. The imagination of Madeline L'Engle, always curious about stories and lives of those who have shaped us and the world around us. And the pragmatic, hopeful faith of Frederick Buechner, whose prolific written ministry is the treasure we will continue to discover. Like all of the wonderful church history articles Ardienne shared with us at First Church. I have no doubt that Timothy, from our scripture, didn't feel ready for Paul to die. How would he ever fill those shoes? Paul knew this wasn't about him. It was about the new life Christ makes possible, not bound by darkness, sin, or death ultimately, but by light and freedom and life abundant, already here with more to come. So Paul tells Timothy, "As for you, be sober in everything, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, carry out your ministry fully." The way God is calling you to live your ministry will be different than Ardienne's. She knew that. And because of her faith in God and love for you, she wanted to leave you with a blessing and encouragement for you to carry the story and do the good work God has called you to. So feel God's blessing as you remember the special ways you know Ardienne, and as we listen to "The Lord Bless You and Keep You."
Thank you.
With that blessing, we hold this time of remembrances. We will hear from Karen Anderson and Phil Damicis, and then offer a few moments for others to share a brief memory or something you love about Ardienne. And so now I invite Karen forward to share.
Thank you all for joining together today to celebrate a life well lived and to acknowledge our shared loss. I am Karen Anderson. Ardienne Beverly Waldron Damicis is my second cousin. I use the present tense because she is still present. Present in our memories and our stories. Present in her thoughtfulness and kind deeds. Present in the education of her many students and in the organizations to which she generously gave her energy. And sadly, present in how she had to handle her illness, but with grace and dignity, setting an example for all of us. Ardienne was born just after the Great Hurricane of 1938. Her mother suffered a ruptured appendix during delivery. Consequently, baby girl Waldron was in care also. The nurses nicknamed her Wally. It wasn't until Dan became part of her life and our family, we learned to call her Ardienne. And it was a trick after all those years. Coincidentally, Ardienne arrived in a hurricane and departed in one of the windiest torrential rainstorms in recent memory. In her childhood, Ardienne lived in different and interesting locations before becoming a permanent Woodmont resident. It was a while before we all realized that Woodmont was actually a part of Milford. But her adventures were not limited just to Woodmont. While in Cornell, she had a pen pal. Back in the days when everyone used pen, paper, and stamps, and actually wrote letters. Her pen pal was from Japan, and after graduation, she traveled to visit her and spent several months traveling around Japan. However, it was not a simple transoceanic flight, but rather, she signed on with a service that arranged workers for merchant ships, not a lot of luxury. She worked both ways as a secretary and a cook for reduced fare, and I would say the experience of a lifetime. Ardienne lived two blocks up from the beach. She was a strong swimmer and loved the sand. Thus, she met Dan on the beach in front of 64 Beach Avenue. The rest is history. But I do believe she kept him a secret for quite a while. As a teenager, I would spend time with Ardienne, enjoying the sand and the salt air. On one of these occasions, she said her friend Dan was making lunch for us. In the backyard, Dan had the grill going with sausage, peppers, and onions, and I'm sure homemade sauce, with a huge fresh-baked loaf of Italian bread. I had never had a sausage and pepper grinder, but was instantly hooked and was initiated into a Damicis family tradition, many more to follow. But Ardienne was cautious. She dated Dan for almost 25 years before they married. But they were married for 30 years. Ardienne was the consummate teacher in all aspects of her life. Although fun, our excursions always involved a learning experience or a teachable moment. We rode the carousel at Savin Rock until we were dizzy. And then we rode it again. I think it had something to do with geometry and how far we would have gone if that circle were a straight line and how to figure a circumference so we'd know how big the circle was. And also a lesson in excess, the total teachable moment. How many times is it prudent for your stomach to do that on top of a cheeseburger and French fries? Trips with my children were also fun learning experiences. Dinosaur Park in Rocky Hill was one such event. Let's make a plaster cast of a dinosaur footprint. Sounds like a good idea. This included 20 pounds of plaster of Paris, a metal ring well covered in vegetable oil, a little patience for it to set, and done. We had a 20-pound footprint to drag home. And now, what to do with it? Well, it lived between my kids' bedrooms for way too long. Then it seemed only fair it should be returned to Ardienne's classroom. Fortunately, it found a permanent home in one of her cohort's classrooms, a teacher to whom I will be ever thankful. Ardienne taught her students well and remembered them long after they left her formal classroom. When she was in Milford Healthcare, recovering from a surgery, the RN, who was one of her caregivers, had been a former student. This RN also shared with me that her daughter was in Orchard Hill Schools, so there was a legacy there. This lovely young woman said, "Miss Waldron," which by the way meant prior to 1989, "I was in your class." Not only did Ardienne remember her, but also remembered where she sat in class and that her hand was always raised, whether she knew the right answer or not. Being a teacher also means being part of the learning experience. Learning to text was our challenge. After her serious oral surgery about 5 years ago, the only effective way to communicate was by texting. Our lack of technical expertise, and of course, not being teenagers, led to frustrating moments, cryptic interpretations, and curious messages. But learn we did. Thanks to patient and savvy friends, we even managed to share pictures on our phones. Every morning, my son, who lives in Nebraska, would send the current sunrise. Every night, Ardienne would text to me, "Sweet dreams." There was a whimsical side to Ardienne as well. She loved Raggedy Ann and even did a look-alike dress-up event. There's pictures on the board. One time when we were in Stockbridge, Massachusetts, in a small country store, she found a Raggedy Ann doll. On closer inspection, she discovered it was made not in America, and Dan would not approve. So I made her a Raggedy Ann doll. When I would visit, Raggedy would always be someplace new, on her nightstand, on the table overlooking the water, at the dining room table, or elsewhere. And finally, toward the end, resting with her on the next pillow. She, being the genealogy expert, we are officially second cousins, officially. Through her diligent research, she connected us both with the Mayflower Society and the Daughters of the American Revolution. Our searches through dusty archives took us to neighboring states in search of ancient relatives. Two of the most elusive being Tertullius and Mehitable. The explanations of these names is far too cumbersome for now, but suffice to say, we found Mehitable, but not Tertullius. If any of you have a Tertullius in your family history, we might be related, and Ardienne would have been very happy. Ardienne was all about family. She came from a small, quiet family, but embraced and enjoyed Dan's wonderful, large, fun family. And bless the Damicis family for the love and care they lavished on Ardienne. Her front porch is legend. Celebrations and rousing conversations and greeting passers-by. One time, with my friends there, a young woman visiting from Australia asked if she could take our picture, as she thought we looked like quintessential Americana. We often wondered if we were immortalized in a coffee table photo album a half a world away. Ardienne had great patience with everyone, but especially those who could not pronounce her name, despite valiant tries. How many times she repeated it slowly and even spelled it clearly, as a teacher would do, letter by letter, but would end up saying, look, it's sardine, without the S. And she would often add, and you won't hear another one like it. Never a souvenir coffee mug or a key tag to match. However, our dear friend, a dairy farmer, named one of my Guernsey cows in her honor. Ardienne joked that she had a Mayflower and a DAR pedigree, and now a pedigreed heifer named Ardienne. Such a great sense of humor. Ardienne was generous with her talents. Even as her illness progressed, and she was unable to enjoy the wonderful things she made, she continued to bake the wonderful cinnamon raisin bread and gift it generously. She said she loved the smell of baking that bread and knew that we would enjoy it. I still have one loaf in the freezer, waiting for a special or maybe even a sacred occasion. She also loved to propagate aloe plants. So much so, the offer was, please take some plants, I'll even give you the pots. She also dried her herbs and have seasoned many a casserole. Many of them came from the herb garden at the colonial houses that she lovingly tended. And our Christmas arrangements have had abundant holly from her prolific bush. The list is long. It is important to acknowledge her illness and her courageous struggle, done with grace and dignity, not letting her illness define her. As we became Team Ardienne, our families, our neighbors, our friends, we did what we could do to help. Ardienne knew this struggle would ultimately end. However, she chose to endure. Yes, partially because she and we wanted more time. But when the clinical trials began, she was doing the therapy in hopes the result might benefit someone else in the future. That person will never know her name, but will benefit from who she chose to be. The stories should continue. And I hope they will. That is what keeps her legacy alive. Please share your stories and your memories. That is the honor of a life well lived and one that deserves. As we know, Ardienne loved sunflowers. When you see them, think of her sunny personality, her strength, her resilience. Be inspired by her accomplishments. Be comforted by her courage. Remember her friendship. There is a poem, The Rose Beyond the Wall. I'm taking literary license and changing it to Our Sunflower Beyond the Wall. A sunflower once grew where all could see, sheltered by a garden wall. And as the days passed swiftly by, its blooming stalk grew straight and tall. One day, a beam of light shone through, a crevice that had opened wide. The sunflower gently bent towards its warmth, then passed beyond to the other side. Now you who deeply feel its loss, be comforted. Our sunflower blooms there, its beauty even greater now, nurtured by God's own loving care. Sweet dreams, Ardienne. We love you. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Phil Damicis, Ardienne's nephew, and I'd like to share a few of my memories of Ardienne. My earliest memories of Ardienne are from the beach house of Woodmont, where she was introduced to the Damicis family by my uncle Dan. Having grown up in Greenwich, Connecticut, in an English family, I'm sure she was a bit taken back by our somewhat colorful Italian-American family. Picture this. It's a beautiful summer day in Woodmont, and Ardienne is relaxing on the beach, quietly reading a book. Meanwhile, my cousins, some who are here today, are foraging the tidal pools of Woodmont for snails that we would put in the upstairs bathtub for my grandfather to turn into scongeli salad while my dad and my uncles were spearfishing blackfish at the point. Now later that night, my dad and uncles would drag a 30-foot net along the shore for shiners. Most people would use shiners for bait, not the Damicis family. My cousins and I would put these little fish in buckets, bring them back to the house, where my aunts, including my aunt Annabelle, would pull off the heads, dredge them in flour, fry them in oil, and we'd eat them like French fries with bones and tails intact. Yes, this was likely a bit of a culture shock for Ardienne, but fortunately not enough to scare her off. Later in my childhood, I had the opportunity to experience Ardienne at her finest. As a teacher at Orchard Hills Elementary, she would occasionally let me spend the day with her fourth grade class and took me on field trips to Talcott Mountain Observatory and Bridgeport Museum of Science. As with most things in Ardienne's life, Ardienne was in full command of her class, but had also the respect which came from their true admiration of her. Years later, as a freshman at UConn, I was reunited with one of those students who ended up living in my dorm. He remembered me as the kid who Miss Waldron used to bring to field trips. He later told me that Ardienne was his favorite teacher and how inspirational she had been to him. I'm sure he was just one of hundreds of students that Ardienne had this kind of impact on. Throughout the rest of her life, Ardienne continued to give me great memories. Some of my favorites are the following. Her and my Uncle Dan traveling up to Augusta, Maine to be the first to meet our daughter Jessica when she was born. Eating her homemade corn relish while having cocktails on the porch, or simply just having great conversations on the porch. Visiting her and Dan with our three kids on after-dinner walks to the park during the years we lived in Woodmont. Even the times when our daughter Jennifer would try to pull apart their antique wicker furniture. Watching the Woodmont Day Parade with her and her neighbors. Her homemade raisin bread, which is legendary, which my friends at work would look forward to and refer to as Ardienne bread. The wonderful four-course dinners with her and Dan that were finished off with one of her amazing fresh-baked pies. The pear was one of our favorites. Gardening with her in her extensive perennial gardens, where she taught Kathy and I how to fit 10 yards of clippings into a 30-gallon leaf bag by meticulously clipping each one of these pieces into 3-inch pieces. My most important memories of Ardienne, though, are from the last couple of years. These are memories of her strong will and appreciation of life, even when things weren't going well. They are memories that are hard to quantify and are more of a feeling. I'm sure many of you here know what I'm talking about. In spite of her illness, she refused to stop living and seemed at times to be even stronger because of it. She greeted friends and family with a smile no matter how tough a day she was having and always focused on the positive. She chose to be happy when others would have been sad. Even during the roughest times, she continued to put out the flag each morning because she knew how much it meant to my Uncle Dan. We could all learn a lesson from Ardienne on how to enjoy each day, regardless of our situation. I'm sure all of you here also have special memories of Ardienne. As one of my favorite authors, Dr. Seuss, once said, "Don't cry because it's over. Smile because it happened." Ardienne, thank you for all the great memories that happened because of you.
And would anyone else like to share a brief memory or just something that you loved about Ardienne, even if it's raisin bread? Okay, you may stand or you may come to the microphone. Please come. Yes, ma'am. You may stand. Any others? Oh, yes, sir.
I'm Dave Gregory. In the Ardienne with a friend. I would set up there for a while, and she'd be over there. And then I moved down to the stained glass window, and if she was coming in late, she'd come and sit with me. And a few weeks ago, she came in, and she said she was going to sit down here so she could hear better. And I said, okay. And I said, I have a story. Would you like to read the story? I'm typing it up. When I'm finished, I'll send it to you. And I did. And then she told me how she was planning her life. And liked my story. And she was not alone.
Thank you. All right. Yes, ma'am. All right. Well, neither Adam nor I feel badly that she had another favorite minister. So with that and so many things to be thankful for, I'll turn it over to Adam.
We continue to carry her story, and I invite you to do so and share memories with each other in the days to come. But now let us give thanks in prayer. Merciful God, we thank you for your word and for words of remembrance to keep our Dean's spirit alive in our hearts. We thank you for her deep calling of teaching children. We give thanks for her love of Dan and his for her that saw them through sickness and health, challenge and concern throughout their life together. We thank you for her family whom she adored, for Karen, for Phil, for Bill, their families, for neighbors and students and friends who shared so much with her over the years. We thank you for her service to build community and also to connect this present community back with our history. We thank you for the passionate way she would share stories, for her diligence and attention to detail, for her humor and charm. We are grateful for her good and grateful service with First Church, with the Historical Society, with the DAR, with the Friends of the Milford Library, with the Milford Preservation Trust, the Milford Land Trust, the Mayflower Society, the Friends of the Milford Cemetery. We stand in awe of her generosity of spirit and her giving of time and talent. We thank you also, O God, for all who cared for Ardienne and for her gracious spirit through uncertainty and pain. We thank you that Ardienne is reunited with those who have gone before her. We thank you, God, we have the light of our memories, the light of each other, and the light of your promises, as well as our Dean's own encouragement to us to sustain us and comfort us. Through our tears, give us a vision to see in faith the consolation that you intend for us, and in your mercy, grant us the unfailing guidance of your saving word, both in life and through death. Through Jesus Christ, our risen Savior. Amen. And now, would all who are able please stand as we sing one of our Dean's favorite hymns, Nearer My God to Thee, which is hymn number 351 in the red-covered pilgrim hymnal.
Thank you.
Please remain standing for the prayer of commendation. Let us pray. O merciful Savior, you have already received Ardienne into your eternal embrace. We praise you for receiving your servant as a daughter of your redemption into the blessed rest of everlasting peace and into the company of the saints. Amen. After the benediction and conclusion of this service, you are invited to a reception in Fellowship Hall located downstairs through the chancel or through the narthex and stairs. And now, my friends, receive the benediction. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May God look upon you with kindness and give you peace. Let us go forth in the name of the risen Christ who keeps God's child, Ardienne, in peace now and forever. Amen.